All right, good morning, everyone. Let's rise up this morning. One thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest.
My doubt, you were faithful then.
deliverer, and you will fight my enemies. This will end in victory, and I will believe it. I will believe it. You make mountains move, you make giants fall, you use songs of praise to shake prison walls. I will speak to my fear, I will preach to my doubt. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. And I know that I know you never fail. And I know that I know you never will. Yes, I know that I know you never fail. And I know that I know you never will. Yes, I know that I know you never fail. Yes, I know that I know you never will. And I know that I know you never fail. Yes, I know that I know you never will. I know that I know you never fail. That's right. Yes, I know that I know you never will. And I know that I know you never fail. Yes, I know that I know you never will. You make mountains move, you make giants fall. You use songs of praise to shake prison walls. I will speak to my fear, I will preach to my doubt. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. You make giants fall. You use songs of praise to shake prison walls. I will speak to my fear, I will preach to my doubt. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now.
Amen. Would you believe that today?
Just one move.
Oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. It's all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, of nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing
Father God in heaven, God, we come before you today. We shouted out hallelujah to your holy name. God, you are wonderful and the master of our wonderful universe, God. We don't have much to offer, but this is what we bring here today to you. And we ask, God, that you accept our time of worship. We love you, God. We thank you for who you are as we worship you here today. And God, ask your blessing us. We prepare our hearts and our minds today as Cameron comes and brings your word. And we open up our ears and our minds to hear what you have to say. We love you and we praise you in the name of Jesus. And we shout it out with me today. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
I invite your attention this morning to John chapter 21. Recommend filling out a connection card if this is your first time here. You get a free gift. My name is Cameron Bean. I'm a member here at Sunbreak. I am married to my high school sweetheart, Kate. Together, God has granted us two amazing kids, Autumn, who's 11, Pierce, who is 9. If you smell smoke in the building and see fire, it's probably my children. I'm kind of tingly right now because I haven't been able to preach to you since we've lifted some of these mandates, and which means that there are some brand new faces here, which I'm so excited about, because Bobby has asked me to come and finish our sermon series on Let Me Tell You About My Jesus. And if you know me, you'll know that there is not a subject that I'm more excited about than talking about Jesus. So today, let me tell you about my Jesus. A little bit of context for where we're going, a little context for the passage of scripture that we're going to find in John 21. Jesus is God. Jesus was, he was born, we don't see a lot of his childhood. We see a couple of small illustrations. It's not until his ministry begins that we see a big picture window of Christ. We see a big picture window of Jesus. We see it in his ministry. One of the very first things that we see him do is go and build his church. We see him call out this group of believers. One of these people is a man named Peter. Now, Peter is one of my favorite Bible characters because he reminds me of myself. He's impetuous. He has to learn things the hard way. And so many times we see Peter, and he does something great, and then he does something dumb. And this is Peter. We're going to see some of these moments today. Jesus had a perfect life. He never sinned. Sin, that's an ugly word, isn't it? Sin is one of those words. If you've ever made a mistake, if you've done something wrong, if you've fallen short of God's perfect standard, we call it sin. Jesus never did that. He started his ministry. He lived and worked his ministry next to these men for 3 years. And his ministry was coming to an end. All that time, he'd been building leadership into Peter for the future. Well, the night before Jesus gave his life as a perfect sacrifice to atone for our sins, Jesus sat down with these guys and said, "Listen, gentlemen, I'm going to the cross. I'm going to die." And Peter says, "I'm not going to let that happen. I'm going to be there with you forever, Jesus. I'm going to be standing beside you no matter what." And Jesus said, "Peter, I love you, man, but you're going to deny me 3 times before the morning. You're not me." And Peter says, no, that's not going to happen. And all of a sudden, here comes this flock of guards coming to arrest Jesus. They're coming to arrest him, and they're going to take him to this trial so that they can get rid of him. All the political leaders, they didn't like Jesus because Jesus was a little bit different. Peter, he takes a sword out. He's the only guy with a sword, and he brings a sword, and he cuts Malchus's ear off, and Jesus puts a miraculous new ear onto Malchus and saves the day again. And Peter watches as Jesus is arrested and taken. Well, Peter and another disciple, they follow Jesus to the place, the house where these leaders were having this mock trial for Jesus. They were going to have this mock trial and find a way to get the government to kill him off. And Peter is outside in the courtyard of this house, of this beautiful residence. And there's a lot of people there because there's a lot of leaders inside the house, so there's a lot of servants outside the house. And they're all standing around this charcoal bonfire. They're warming themselves. It's a little cool. It's the middle of the night. And they are outside warming themselves. When someone comes up to Peter and says, "Hey, I recognize you. You were with Jesus, weren't you?" "No, I never met that guy. I don't know who that is. I don't know Jesus." He stands there a little longer, and he's worried and nervous about Jesus. "How's it going up there? Is everything okay? Is there anything I can do?" And then somebody else comes up, and he says, "You look like you've been with Jesus. You sound like him." Isn't that such a compliment? Isn't that what you want someone to say about you? "Wow, you look like you've been walking with Jesus for a while. You're just so kind and nice, and you're just so loving." Isn't that? That's not what Peter wanted to hear. Peter said, "No, I'm not with that Jesus guy. I don't know him. I don't know that guy." And he's still sitting there beside the fire, you know, warming his hands. And it's been a long time. It's been a few hours. And then somebody comes up to him, a little girl, probably around my daughter's age, comes up to him and says, "I think that you were with Jesus. You look like a Galilean." And the text tells us, hey, this guy started cussing at this little girl, started swearing at the little girl, started saying, "I never met that guy. I don't know who you're talking about. I haven't been around Jesus." And all of a sudden in his ear, he hears the rooster crow the morning. And then he realizes, "I just denied Christ 3 times. He looks up and he makes eye contact with Jesus. And immediately Peter drops. Poof, his soul drops. Could you imagine the shame? I just did exactly what Jesus said I was going to do. I've denied him 3 times. I'm not here. I'm not the person I thought I was. I'm not capable." The shame, the disappointment that Peter had at that moment. Well, Peter disperses. He doesn't follow Christ to the cross, but Jesus does go to the cross. Jesus does go, and he is given as a sacrifice. He gives himself as a sacrifice, and Jesus dies and is buried in a rich man's tomb, and he was laid there for 3 days. Third time's a charm. He was laid there for 3 days, and on the third day, three ladies named Mary, third time's a charm, three ladies named Mary come up and to go finish the burial procedure for Jesus. And he's not in there. The big stones rolled. He's not in there. Where is he at? And then Jesus is there, and he says to Mary, he says, there's three Marys. He says to Mary, "Here I am." So what are you worried about? Who are you looking for? They've taken my Lord. Here I am. Go and tell my apostles and Peter. Go tell my disciples and Peter that I'm back. I don't know if Mary did or not. I don't know if Mary got there. Mary was obedient to God. I think Mary made it. I think Mary told Peter. I think the moment that we're about to see here, he knew that something happened. Jesus was out of there, and then some guy said, maybe Jesus is back. I think that Mary told Jesus. I think he made it there. And that brings us to our text today. That's the context for John chapter 21. Now we see Simon Peter again. Beginning in verse 2, Simon Peter, that's our guy, Thomas, called Twin, Nathanael from Cana of Galilee, Zebedee's sons, and two other of his disciples were together. I'm going fishing, Simon Peter said to them. We're coming with you, they told him. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. When daybreak came, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Friends, Jesus called to them, you don't have any fish, do you? No, they answered. Cast the net on the right side of the boat, he told them, and you'll find some. So they did, and they were unable to haul it in because of the large number of fish. The disciple, the one Jesus loved, said to Peter, it is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he tied his outer clothing around him, for he had taken it off, and plunged into the sea. Since they were not far from land, about 100 yards away, 100 yards is actually pretty far to swim. The other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish. When they got out on land, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish lying on it and bread. Bring some of the fish you've just caught, Jesus told them. So Simon Peter climbed up and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. Even though there were so many, the net was not torn. Come, have breakfast, Jesus told them. None of the disciples dared to ask him, who are you? Because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread, and gave it to them. He did the same with the fish. This was now the third time. Third time's a charm. The third time Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had eaten breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said to him. You know that I love you. Feed my lambs, he told him. A second time he asked him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Yes, Lord, he said to him, you know that I love you. Shepherd my sheep, he told him. He asked him a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was grieved that he asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Feed my sheep. The title of my lesson today is Third Time's a Charm. Let's pray. Dear Lord, most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you that we're able to come together. Please open our minds, our ears, and our hearts to your word. Help us to apply it to our lives. Help us to see you in a brand new way, Father. And help get me out of the way so I can preach just the way you want to preach it. I love you so much. In Jesus' name, and everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Have you ever misjudged someone? Have you ever misjudged someone? Okay, I got a story. Okay. So my wife and the kids and I, we went on vacation, I don't know, about a month ago, maybe 2 months ago, and I had the great opportunity to misjudge someone. We wanted to go see Orcas Island. We wanted to go to the San Juans. We'd heard about these Washington Islands for a long time, but we'd never been, and so we were expecting Tahiti. So we went and got in line at Anacortes. We got in line to go to Orcas Island. We were going to get on the ferry. We actually got there and said, hey, when's a boat leaving to one of the islands? Which one do you want? I don't care. Which one's next? Okay, you're going to Orcas Island today. Sounds great. We get in line. We didn't know that the ferry system was having a labor shortage and that we were going to have a significant amount of time in our vehicle. We got in line when we thought was just in time, which was an hour early, which gave us the opportunity to do some people watching. And there are a lot of interesting individuals going to Orcas Island. And it was a nice day. We were watching people. We're sitting there. We're readers. We were reading our books. And all of a sudden, a couple cars ahead of me, I saw this gentleman pop out of his car, and it was hate at first sight. I really didn't like this guy. He was wearing a neon pink sweatshirt, and I was angry that he was so secure with his manhood that he could wear this. He had a haircut of a boss I had 20 years ago, the facial expression of somebody who cut me off in traffic, and the way that he talked to his kids, he was on their level, and just I didn't like the cut of his jib. You know what I'm saying? He was we were not going to be fast friends. I had a great opportunity to misjudge this guy. And I see him, and he's over there running around with his kids. And the family looked normal. The kids were actually cute as a button. They were wearing like one, like they shopped at Target because my kids had the same thing. And they're running around with the kids, and the guy, I look at the kids and I'm so happy, and the mom is just a normal mom, and this guy, look at this guy, how dare he breathe my oxygen? And I see this gentleman, and he goes to the bathroom and he's playing with his kids, and he gets back, and the more I see him, the more angry I am, because he's embodied all of these negative people that I've seen. I've seen a guy like you. I've seen a guy with a face like yours and a haircut like yours and a stupid pink sweatshirt like yours. I don't like it, and I don't like anything about you. That's where I was. But I can't be that way. I've got to be a good Christian, and I'm trying to. I can't dislike this guy based on his appearance. Anyways, he gets back in his car. We get on the ferry boat. And we go up to the lobby area where they've got the seats and you can watch the water and watch the boats. And I'm sitting there with my family, and half of them are sleeping because we woke up early. So I'm sitting there and I'm contemplating. And while I'm contemplating, just thinking about Jesus and being a nice boy, this guy walks back into my vision, and immediately everything about me, I can't stand this guy. It was only for a moment. And then we get back into our cars, we get on the island, and we go and have our fun. We eat dinner, and we're cruising around. And we get back in line, the last boat of the day. Again, labor shortages, 3 hours late. We get back in line for the last boat, and since it's 3 hours late, we have to walk over to the bathroom every hour we're over there. And lo and behold, between my car and the bathroom is this guy with his dog, and they're sitting on a bench, and I just knew that if that dog went to the bathroom, he wasn't going to pick it up. That's the kind of guy he was. I just knew that inside my heart, that this guy was just going to let us sit there. Angry, which makes me, so that was the heart frame, the mindset that I was in, was I was just mad at this guy, which made what happened so significant. Which made that moment when he just became this beautiful human being so great. In this moment when I saw truly who he was, it made it one of these moments where I just knew I'd misjudged this man. Wow, this is an amazing person. And I think that's what so many people do with Jesus, is they have placed all of these thoughts and ideas that they've seen from society on Christ. And they're unwilling to go and see Jesus as he truly is. I've been running towards Jesus for a while, and it is so difficult for me to find somebody who hasn't heard about Jesus. I talk to people frequently, and I say, have you heard about Jesus? Yeah, I hate him because, and they give me a reason about a televangelist or somebody who's got a fish bumper sticker and cut him off on. That's not Jesus. That's the sinful human. That's the person behind. And they based their viewpoint of Christ based on other things other than Christ. I want to introduce you to Jesus. I want to show you what my Jesus looks like. But he's more than just the person that some people who don't know him, he's more than that person that they haven't met. This Jesus looks different to all of us. I don't think, as long as we walk towards Jesus, he's always going to look greater and greater. He's going to look better and better. The more that we learn about him and the farther down the sanctification process we get, the more, I think, we are going to love Jesus and see how awesome he is. This is one of those moments. I open to John 21, and I see this. I want to show you Jesus. Let's look at John 21. We're going to begin in verse 2. I want you to see that Peter, remember broken Peter. Remember, he's so hurt and distraught from denying Christ and denying that he knew him. and Peter's here. And Peter returned to his old life when he sinned. Simon Peter, Thomas called twin, Nathaniel, Zebedee's son, the other two disciples, they were all together. They were hanging out. What does Simon Peter say? I'm going fishing. What is fishing to him? That's his old lifestyle. That's what he did for a living. When he was on his boat, he was in charge. I'm on my boat. I'm going to go fishing. I'm in charge of my future. I'm in charge of my finances. I'm in charge of everything. I get to go out there, and I get to drop the net down, and I get to pick the net up. That's my life. That's where I'm in charge. I'm going fishing. I don't have Jesus. I'm not walking with Jesus. I'm going back to fishing. We're coming with him. We're coming with you. They told him. They went out and got into the boat. That night, they caught nothing. They had a lot of time to pull that net up and catch nothing that night. This is where, whether you know Christ or not, this is what you're trying to do. You're going out there, and you're in control, and I'm doing for me, and I'm going to go where my comfort zone is because I'm not with Jesus. It's a hole. It's a God-sized hole that you've got inside of you. We've all got a God-sized hole inside of us. Every single one of us, saved, unsaved, you've got a God-sized hole inside of you. And they say that, and Christians say that, well, you've got a God-sized hole inside of you. And I think about a Wile E. Coyote. I think about a picture like Wile E. Coyote who's gone through a wall right here, right? And this is like only like the God-sized puzzle piece will fit inside of there. But I look at that, and that's not true, because that right there, there is a room behind it, and I can shove $100 bills into there until they're overflowing and it's all filled up. That's what we do. We try to fill up that God-sized hole, a hole like that, with our job. We'll go and we'll push our job into that hole. We'll go and drive a Porsche into that car. We'll go and we'll push money into that. Or we'll go and we'll... But that's not what the hole actually looks like. Because you can fill that hole up. I can fill that hole up. That's not what it looks like. That God-sized hole that you're trying to fill is actually a bottomless pit. You've got a bottomless pit inside of your soul. You take that, you start shoveling money into there, and you'll be filled as long as you can see it. You'll be full with that money, millions of dollars, as long as you can see it, but it's going to be gone in a moment. That feeling is going to be gone as soon as you can't see it anymore. Have you experienced that? You can throw your job into there, and as long as you can see it, until it goes out of sight, it's going to fill you. You can put a house into there. It's just going to fall to the bottom, and there is no bottom. It's just going to keep falling. You can drive the Porsche into there. You can drive a Ferrari into there. It's as long as you can see it, and then it'll be out of sight. And then we start to fill it with sin. We start to fill it with bad relationships. We start to fill it with, name the sin. That's what you start to fill it with. The only way that you can fill a bottomless hole is with something that never ends. The only way that you can fill a hole with no ending is to put something that has no end into it. That's God. God has no beginning. God has no end. You put God in there, and he finds the bottom, fills it up, and he's still sitting there asking you to come swim inside of him. He fills that bottomless hole. Peter couldn't fill that bottomless hole with fishing, and he caught no fish that night. He couldn't go back to his old life. He still had that bottomless hole because Jesus wasn't there. Which brings us to Jesus. Oh, look at Jesus. And then came Jesus. And then came Jesus. Look at verses 4 through 7. When daybreak came, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not know it was Jesus. Friends, Jesus called them. You don't have any fish, do you? Yeah, good looking out, buddy. Empty boat, no fish. You're right, got it. I mean, this was not a God test. This was a vision test. They'd been out all night. There's no big pile of fish here. And that would have, had it been me, and I'd been fishing all night, and I had an empty boat, I'd be pretty upset if the guy on the shore said, hey, buddy, you did a terrible job at fishing last night, didn't you? That would upset me. Nope, sure didn't. Cast the net on the right side of the boat. Who's this joker? who's this guy? I've been out here all night. And then we remember, and then Peter remembers. This is like the third time's a charm. This is like the third big moment on the water that we see Peter. First, we saw Peter out there. He lends Jesus his boat, and Jesus goes out there and teaches, and then Jesus gives him a huge haul of fish. And then we see Peter trying to walk on the water, and then he falls in because he's Peter and not God. And then here we are again on this third time. We see this third moment, and I would have been upset at this guy telling me to go throw the net on the other side of the boat. Man, I've been on both sides of this boat all night long. You're going to tell me that I'm going to come over here and drop the... But he would have remembered. Cast the net on the right side of the boat, he told them, and you'll find some. So they did. And they were unable to haul it in from God's plentiful bounty that he had provided for them. The disciple, the one Jesus loved, said to Peter, "It is the Lord." Oh, it's God. It's Jesus. He's here. It is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he remembered that he was in his underwear. Oh, I'm in my underwear. And he went and grabbed his coat, and he put it back on, and he tied it to himself. And these coats were heavy. These coats would keep out the 100-degree weather, or they'd keep them warm and keep them cool. And it was this giant coat, and he pulls it onto himself, and then he jumps into the water, and it's 100 yards, and he's already got to swim 100 yards. And now he put an anchor onto himself. But he did that because he was so amazed that it was Jesus. Oh, it is Jesus. It is the Lord. Thank goodness. And he forgot about his shame, and he forgot about that feeling that he had. He forgot about that sin. All he knew was it was Jesus, and he had to go to Jesus. He had to go to Christ. He forgot about that. And it reminds me, when I was a kid, I used to go with my parents, and this has happened in my life, but when I was a kid, I'd go to Sears with my mom, but they don't have Sears anymore. And then we'd go over to Mervyn's, which was, they don't have Mervyn's anymore. So now we take our kids to like Kohl's or Macy's or something. And the round racks with the clothes, maybe sitting in there looking for your size and you're opening it up. And for like 3 seconds, your mom forgets that you're there. Just for like 3 seconds because she's looking for the thing. And that's the perfect time. And then the mom looks up. Where's my kid? Where'd my kid go? Where's my kid? And you're scared. Where's my kid at? Oh, as a kid, you make it last about 3 seconds too long, and they're hiding inside the rack of clothes, and they're watching mom, and then they pop out. I'm here, mom. Ha ha, I scared you. And the first thing that the mother does, oh, thank God you're here. Thank God. I'm so happy you're here. And that feeling of the dread being drained away is the only thing that the parent feels, is the removal of that feeling of fear. Oh, thank goodness. But there's an emotion that comes directly after that. There's an emotion, it's called discipline. There's a disciplinary action afterwards. And that's when my mother would take us to the car. In the same way, Peter had this reaction. Peter had this moment where he no longer remembered that sin and shame. I'm so happy it's Jesus. And he goes and he ties his cloth to himself, which he didn't need because Jesus knows everything and Jesus has seen him in his underwear, man. He didn't need his cloak, but he thought about it anyways. I need this to be in front of Christ. I need this to be in front of my Lord. I need to come to him respectfully. And he takes his cloak and he jumps in the water and he swims as hard as he can after a full night of work. And he'd forgotten about that, but in the same way, a moment later, that emotion might just change. Peter gets to shore, man. He swam, and he's got the thing, and he gets to shore. Since they were not far from land, about 100 yards, bro, 100 yards, that's a lot. That's 300 feet. That's a football field to swim against currents and all kinds of stuff. That's a long ways. The other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish. When they got out on land, they saw a charcoal fire there, with fish lying on it and bread. Look at Jesus, he's so cool. Look at Jesus, he's so cool. Because he's got fish there, right? He's got a bunch of fish there. That's what we just said, charcoal fire, fish lying on it and bread. And what does Jesus do? Peter, bring some of your fish. bring some of the fish you've caught. And he pushes his fish aside, and he's inclusive, and he says, bring yours. Bring what you've got. So Simon Peter climbed up and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. Even though there were so many, the net was not torn. And this is the moment when I think about Peter, and I think about, had I just had this emotional whirlwind happen in my life where I've got, where I found out that it's the Lord and Jesus is back, and this is the man, and I'm just so excited to see him, and I jump in the water, and I swim, 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 and I get to shore. What's that smell? It's fish, but what's that other smell? You know what he smelled? You know what he smelled? Right? Charcoal fire? Barbecue. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Exercise. Close your eyes. I put that bag of Kingsford out there. What do you remember? What do you smell? Do you smell it? You smell it, right? You can already smell that barbecue. You can smell the charcoal burning. You can smell the lighter fluid. What do you think of? You think of 1,000 summer days. You think about beaches where you've been able to barbecue with your friends, your family. You think about these moments when everything is perfect in your life. I remember Thanksgivings where I lived in a bachelor pad, and my dad would always have steak and potatoes for Thanksgiving. And that was like the only time that he would barbecue. And I remember this, and this is one of those joyful moments. Does it bring you joy in your heart to think about this barbecue smell, this Kingsford smell? What do you think Peter thought of? Last time in the scripture we saw him, he was next to a charcoal fire. Last time we saw him next to a fire, smelling that smell, he was denying Christ. Immediately he gets to shore, and it hits him. That emotion just rushes over him, floods over him. Oh, that's right. I'm so excited to see Jesus. I failed him. And that shame comes back over him. I believe. I think that that's exactly how he felt. He smelled that, and the last time I smelled that was when I was denying the Lord. And he would have had this emotional, repentant heart. I've failed. That would have been the moment. And Jesus just brings him over, and Jesus is just so cool because he knows, because Jesus knows everything. And he knows how he's feeling. He said, Peter, come to me. Bring your fish. Bring what you have. Bring it to me. We'll put it on the fire. Can you imagine a breakfast cooked by Jesus? Like, seriously? I couldn't imagine a better breakfast. But that's what Jesus did. Jesus made Peter breakfast. Look at verses 12 through 14. Come, 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 have breakfast. Jesus told them. None of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? Because they knew. They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came. He took the bread and he gave it to them. He's serving them. He did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. Now, Jesus is so cool because he knew Jesus had to go and meet Peter. Jesus was right there. Jesus met him where he was. Peter returned to his old life. And at the end of that night, Peter was coming to shore with nothing to show for his efforts. He tried to take the reins of his life, and it came out empty. And Jesus was right there. Peter just turned around. And Jesus was right there behind him. And Jesus said, you don't have any fish, right? And he did the whole thing. Jesus met him there. And you know what those men needed right then? You know what those men needed after a long night of fishing? They needed a meal. They needed sustenance. Jesus gave them exactly what they needed. Sometimes we can meet Jesus for breakfast. Sometimes we can meet Jesus in these glorious moments, and we can say, wow, that looks like Christ. Yeah, it looks like Jesus did that. But oftentimes we say that, well, I provided that breakfast. Well, look, it's my fish on there. Who gave him the fish? Jesus gave him the fish, 153 of them. It's so easy to say, no, that's me, I did that. That's why sometimes he uses different methods to get our attention. Sometimes he wants to gain our attention through breakfast. Sometimes he uses other means. And sometimes it takes other things to get our attention. I want to be the guy who just has, Jesus, you've got my full attention. You've given me everything. You've blessed me with everything. And I want to praise you through all of that. But sometimes to get our attention, he uses other methods. Whatever it takes, Jesus is going to meet you where you're at. He wants to meet you there. And he's going to come and get you with whatever means he needs to. Does that make sense? Is that clear? Sometimes it's not pretty. Sometimes it's pretty. And sometimes he's got to get your attention with something that's not pretty. Is that clear enough? These men needed breakfast. Jesus could feel the repentant heart of Peter. He could feel the shame. And he knew Peter's actions. And Jesus returned to Peter. I mean, I don't see Jesus interacting with any of the other disciples besides handing them the food and being a polite host. But it looks like he's here for Peter. That's what it almost looks like, doesn't it? Can I give you a wake-up call? Can I tell you something? Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. He loves everyone. He died because he loves you so much. He loves everyone so much. But Jesus loves you, and he loved Peter. I want you to look at verses 15 through 17 today. 15 says, when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said to him. You know that I love you. Feed my lambs, he told him. A second time he asked him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Yes, Lord, he said to him. You know that I love you. Shepherd my sheep, he told him. He asked him a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was grieved that he asked him a third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Feed my sheep. On the surface, this looks like Jesus is reaffirming him three times. Third time's a charm, right? He's reaffirmed him three times. Why did he reaffirm him three times? Because Peter denied him three times, right? And in the Bible, we see this number three. And Bible scholars use this number. What is number three so significant? It's completeness. Not as much as the number seven. And you start reading after all these things. And number three is this sign of the complete and finished product. And that's why number three is so significant here. And God made this happen in such a way, and in this group of threes, that we can see that God is trying to convey completeness. That's true, 100%. But if we go just one layer lower, we're going to see that this is so much more. That this is exactly what the last passage was. That Jesus is meeting him where he's at. But for me to explain this to you, for me to show you, I got to give you a Greek lesson. And I know that you love Greek lessons so much. We're going to teach you some Greek, okay? When I say the word love, there's three different varieties of love in the Greek. The first one, eros. Everyone say eros. Eros. Eros is where we get the word erotic from. And that's the love that I only have for my wife. It's eros. Eros is the love of lovers. Eros. She loves it when I do that. Filio. Everyone say filio. Filio. I love all of you. I love you like my brothers and sisters in Christ. Filio. This is where we get the word Philadelphia from. Brotherly love. This is the love of brothers, the love of family. This is the love that we have for each other. Filio. This is a great love. Filio is a great love. So everybody say filio. Filio. But there's one more. There's one more love. Oh, and this is the love. Everybody say agape. Agape love. Now, this is the love of God. This is the love I don't even think we're capable to understand. Like, I can give you a picture of agape love, but in our sinful bodies, we can't love like this. We can't do this because our love is going to break down sooner or later. Enough pressure can be applied, and we're not perfect. Agape love is only capable, only possible by God. Agape. This is why God came, because he has agape love. He has unconditional love. comes with its own set of conditions, different. He has to treat human beings in a certain way. But make no mistake, everything God has done is out of love. Everything God has done is out of agape. Now, let's read this passage again. So we've got eros, phileo, agape. When they had eaten breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you agape me more than these? Do you agape me more than these?" Now look at Peter. He's looking down at his empty plate. He's eating his breakfast. And this is the moment. This is what he's been waiting for, right? This is brass tacks time. Do you agape me more than these? Simon Peter looks down. Yes, Lord, he said to him. You know that I phileo you. Feed my lambs. Second time he asked him. Simon, son of John, do you agape me? How can I agape you, Lord? You know what I've done. You know where I was. You know that I denied you. You called it. You saw me. We made eye contact. How can you ask me that? Agape. Yes, Lord. You know that I phileo you. I can't agape you. I tried. I've tried so hard. Shepherd my sheep, told him. Gave him a job. Still has a job. He asked him a third time. Look at this. Look at Jesus. Simon, son of John, do you phileo me? Peter was grieved. Peter was grieved and asked him. He was grieved because Jesus met him where he was. He was grieved. Yes, I phileo you. I can't agape you. I'm not God. I'm just man. It's almost as if God's saying, you know that you can't do what I do. You know that I'm the one. I'm the Lord. I'm the Messiah. I'm the only one capable of agape. Do you phileo me? He met him where he was. He knew what he was capable of. He knew who Peter was. Peter, do you phileo me? This is what he was looking for. I know you can't agape me. I know that all you've got is phileo. That's what I'm looking for. Peter was grieved that he asked him a third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know everything. Lord, you know everything. You know that I phileo you. Feed my sheep. As soon as he returned to Christ, he was useful for service again. This is Jesus. I want you to know that if you've been running from him, if you haven't met him, he is a good, loving Savior. And he wants to meet you where you're at. If you've been running from him and you know him, return to him. He's so loving, like Peter. He's so loving. And he wants to use you, and he has a job for you. He has something for you to do still. He's right there behind you. He wants to cook you breakfast, but he'll do whatever it takes to get you. Maybe you're following Christ. Maybe you're following Jesus, and you've done everything he said. He's still got more for you. What's next in your life? And the way that I see Jesus, the way that I presented him, and the way that this passage presents Jesus and shows the character and nature of Christ is so rich, because we get to see more than I think that is on the surface. We get to see how much Jesus loves you and how much Jesus wants to meet you where you're at and how much Jesus wants to be a part of your life. And it reminds me that sometimes we don't see him the way that he actually is. Sometimes we've made a bad call. Sometimes we have placed other visions of other people who have done human, sinful things, and we place them on Jesus and say, I don't like Jesus because. And it reminds me of the guy that I saw on the boat. It reminds me of the gentleman that I saw, because I had thought these very same things. I had placed all of these people. I had placed all of these, the pink sweatshirt and the hair and the face and the way that this gentleman was acting and the cut of his jib, and I hated this guy and I didn't like him. I didn't want to have anything to do with him. And I noticed him. And then I got back on the boat. I got back on the boat, and automatically I don't like this guy. And it was late. It was about 3 hours late. And We went over to the vending machines because the family's hungry, and we've got, and oh man, these red vines look fantastic, but they don't take your credit card because cell service isn't good in the middle of the water. So we had to go back down to our car and find this thing called currency that we used to use. And we found exactly $2.50 in the center console of our car, which is, thank God, enough for the red vines. And we go back up, and I go to the first machine, and I start punching money into this machine. I punch the quarters in there, and then I punch a dollar in there, and I start putting the other dollar in, and it goes, bzz, 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 oh, take my dollar. You dumb machine, take my dollar. Bzz, bzz, and it's doing this. And I'm just focused on the machine when I hear beside me, that machine doesn't take any money. And I look over, and you know who it was? The dumb dude in the pink sweatshirt. Thanks, buddy. Appreciate it. Figuring it out. And he said, yeah, that machine doesn't take any money. You have to use this machine. And then I go to hit the give me my money back button, and it gives me my quarters and no dollar bill. It ate my dollar bill, and it wouldn't take my dollar bill. I got $1.50. Red vines are $2.50. Oh no, what do I do? And my boy, he's standing next to me, and he says, Dad, are we going to have the red vines? And I said, no, son. There are no red vines today. We have no red vines. We are going to be hungry tonight. And this gentleman is standing beside me, and he hears me, and he's putting his last dollar bill in to get a Snickers bar. And he looks over at me and says, here's a dollar. No, man, I don't need your dollar. And I look into his eyes, and he says, here's a dollar. And I looked at him, and he was the most beautiful man I've ever seen. He purchased my love with $1. And he walked away, and he walked away, and I just loved the way he walked, and the way that he dealt with his children was so perfect. I had placed so much of my emotion on this gentleman, and I'd seen people that had done me wrong, and people that had presented an ugly persona of all the things that he embodied, but that's not who he was. And that's not who Jesus is. He isn't the ugly things that you have in your mind. If you haven't come to Christ, this is the moment to see that he is beautiful and that he loves you, and he's not the things that you've set on him. Jesus is perfect. That man bought me with a dollar, and it was at the perfect time, but it wasn't the dollar. It was the fact that he was selfless and giving and took it out of his mouth and put it into mine. That was what that man did. And I saw it, and I didn't even have time to thank him. He just turned around thanklessly and went back to his family. He just saw someone in need. He was acting as a good man. Jesus gave so much more than a dollar. Jesus didn't give a dollar. He gave everything. Jesus gave everything. He gave himself as a sacrifice for us. He gave himself as a sacrifice so that we could bring the kingdom to earth and bring souls to him. That's what he came for. That's what he did. He gave so much more than a dollar. He gave everything. I don't want you to misjudge Christ, no matter where you're at. If you've never met Jesus, I invite you today to give your life to him. I invite you today to make him the Lord of your life. But maybe you've been walking with him, and you're so close to him. What's next for you? It doesn't stop. There's no retirement age in the Bible. What's next? Where are you going now? But maybe you're like Peter. Maybe sin has entered your life. And maybe you've walked away. Oh, family, there's never a better time to go back. Oh, family, Jesus is waiting. He wants to meet you where you are. He wants to make you breakfast. He's there. He wants to bless you. He's going to meet you however he can. Today, I invite you. I invite you in prayer. I invite you to return to Christ. I invite you to turn to him for the first time. I invite you today. Please return to Jesus as we sing.
By the weight of your sin, Jesus is called.
As Cameron stated this morning, if you have not accepted Christ, it's as easy as admitting you're a sinner, believing that Jesus is the Son of God, and then confessing with your mouth, and with your heart, and your mind. And that's what it takes to take Jesus into your life. And we hope you do that. If you filled out a connection card for us today, please give it to us or drop it in the box in the back. If it's your first time with us, we'd love to give you a gift. Or if you filled one out online, just let us know. We'd love to give you a gift if it's your first time. Again, thank you guys so much for being with us and for worshiping with us today. Will you pray with me as we dismiss? Father, God in heaven, we proclaim your majesty and glory here today. God, we thank you for calling each one of us. Lord, we accept and we follow after you. God, we thank you for the words that have been spoken today and the time to come and worship you in your holy name. God, go with us this week as we go into the world, Lord, and we want to take you with us. And we want to worship you all week long, not just here on Sunday morning, but all 7 days of the week. God, we love you, and we praise you again in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you so much, everyone. Have a fantastic week, and we'll see you next week.